Welcome to the Spring 2016 Digital Learning Community Question and Answer Session, streaming live on YouTube. Today we will share information with you on behalf of a broad array of district teams who provide school site support to digital learning schools. I'm Marielle Milano, Director for Digital Curriculum and Instructional Design, and this afternoon I'm joined by two colleagues, Chris Ariotti, Program Manager for Digital Curriculum Technology, and Tricia Kottman, Senior Manager for the Asset and Risk Management Department. Moderating this session is Allison Kibbe, Administrator of Instructional Design. So if you're worried that this session might not be for you, don't be. This session is for any parent, student, staff, or community member who has an interest in digital learning happening at their school next year. The names of all of the digital learning schools are on the screen. Cohort 3, which is on the far right side of the screen, is going live in August of this year. OCPS is committed to providing just what you need, just in time. This session is the second of three sessions designed to help families transition to digital learning. If you were not able to attend any of the Parent Academy sessions this year, which focused on the why of digital learning, a recording of that session can be posted to your school's social media site, such as Facebook or Twitter. Today's sessions will focus on the what of digital learning. After today's session, you will be able to understand what digital learning is and be able to identify the changes it will bring for your family. So let's go ahead and get started. Tonight we're going to discuss what is digital learning, what are the goals, what changes can I expect as a parent, what can I do to help prepare my family. Let's begin with what is digital learning. The state of Florida defines digital learning in many ways. They define it as high-quality content in a digital format in online courses, personalized digital learning, a means for the student to demonstrate competency in completed coursework, high-quality content and instructional materials in a digital format, and online and blended learning courses. They also define it as high-quality digital instruction by teachers, infrastructure that supports digital learning, the online administration of assessments, and finally, digital tools for creation, collaboration, and communication. The district has identified five goals for digital learning, which include that all students are digital learners with access to digital tools and resources that help them achieve the Florida standards and close achievement gaps, that all staff are prepared for the next generation of instruction and assessment and use integrated technology and digital tools, that all staff and students demonstrate digital literacy in a secure learning and working environment, that all schools are ready for the next generation of curriculum, instructional technology, and assessment, and finally, that all community members, just like you, have the knowledge and tools necessary to support student achievement. These goals will require a change in the way that the district does business in many areas, and as a result, parents can expect to see changes in the classroom environment, classroom curriculum, classroom instruction, and the homeschool connection. The classroom environment will change dramatically from its current state as we launch students into future-ready learning. There will be changes to the classroom instructional model, the classroom technology provided by the district, the way a teacher organizes their classroom, classroom management, and even basic classroom procedures. First, let's talk about the changes to the instructional model. You may be wondering, when are students going to use technology anyway? And the short answer is, in most things that they do. Students will use technology to support learning every day, in whole group, small group, and individual instruction, facilitated by an in-person teacher. This is called blended learning because it involves a blend of face-to-face instruction, enhanced by the use of technology in a traditional brick-and-mortar school. This is not the same as virtual learning, which occurs totally online, where end students do not attend a brick-and-mortar school. Learning in a blended instruction model does not mean that students will never use paper again, but many classrooms use an overabundance of paper in instruction. The blended model moves classrooms from paper full to paper purposed. Most students will use paper instructional materials only when that functionality is not available in an electronic or digital format, or when it's not developmentally appropriate to do so. In order to enable blended instruction, the district has funded some major changes to classroom technology. Chris is going to tell us more.
Thanks, Mariel. ICTS and facilities are in the process of enhancing classrooms the students will be learning in. Some of the changes they can expect to see include overhead projectors replaced by document cameras that project any document onto the screen for viewing. Whiteboards replaced with interactive projectors displaying lesson content from the teacher. And the most dramatic change, shared workstations will be gone, and all students will be provided a laptop device from which instructional material will be provided. One point I wish to mention about laptop devices is to be sure the student charges their device overnight. There is a limited number of available power outlets in the event a laptop needs charging. Also note that the student needs to bring the supplied charger for their laptop as spares are not available. Having interactive technology in all areas of the classroom will also allow students to move out of traditional rows and into collaborative and interactive small groups that they can get just what they need just in time. As a parent, it's important to remember that with all that movement, students will need a fully charged device to take advantage of the day. Students should plan to charge their devices overnight, as there's limited outlets available at the school for emergency use with the student provided charger.
Thanks, Chris. When you visit a classroom beginning next year, you'll also notice some changes to the procedures. For example, today, when you enter most classrooms, there's worker assignments on the whiteboard ready for students to view and get to work. But next year, students will find that same work in a virtual learning management system such as Edmodo. The benefit to this is that students can engage in online polls and collaboration, giving teachers a better sense of where students are and how to begin their lesson. Now, that's not the only thing that'll change. Nearly everyone has seen a teacher up and walking around the room to ensure that students are engaged and on task. This won't change, but you will also see teachers using classroom management software called LandSchool on their computer in tablet mode to make sure that students are supervised online as well as in the physical environment. We're going to take a brief question break. And if you have any questions, please type them in the chat box. Allison will answer many of your questions in real time, and we'll look for several questions to share with the whole group. We'll come back together in about a minute.
I'm seeing a question around battery not recharging and who would replace the battery. As it is, we will discuss a little bit more later, but as it is, we do take the device back in and have it repaired and issue the student a new device at that time so they're not lost and lose any time with the lessons. So basically, if a battery has died and not taken a charge, we will replace the device at that point.
There's a question about the funding source for digital learning. So the district is lucky to have the support of the community for digital learning. We use both state funding, instructional materials dollars, as well as the digital classroom plan funding and the sales tax in order to assist the district with providing this opportunity for students. Our next question is, how can parents best manage and see all of the homework assignments on a given day? Will all of the teachers assign work on the same Edmodo platforms, and can parents see it all at once? So In general, for homework, we will talk about the planner in just a moment, but as basically a sneak peek, your child's homework will be held in an online planner, and you will be able to see it by class. And then all teachers will use Edmodo as a platform. They may also use Google as a supplemental platform, but Edmodo is working today as our learning management system. And you'll be able to see all of your students' groups at the same time. Let's go ahead and keep moving because I think some of the answers to these questions are coming up right now, and then we'll pause for another question break in just a moment. So the classroom environment is not the only thing that's going to change. There's going to be direct changes to the curriculum as well. The most obvious of these changes will be to instructional materials. Most students will not be required to carry textbooks, but will instead have access to an electronic or digital copy of their textbook that they can access online anytime, anywhere. Reading online textbooks is one of many new skills students will learn. In the past, students learned to be literate in traditional areas such as reading, mathematics, science, and social studies. However, future-ready students, such as yours, must also be literate in digital literacy. But don't worry, this isn't a new class or something that students have to take. It's skills that students will pick up in their existing classes, such as how to be responsible and safe online, how to use digital tools, and how to access all of the information they need in a quick fashion. What questions do you have about the changes to instructional materials? Take to the chat box. Great question about Progress Book. Progress Book is still our official system of record for grading, and parents will be able to log into Progress Book at the beginning of the year, not only to sign our electronic digital learning agreements and parent technology consent forms, but also to check their students' grades. There's a question about whether or not these are the same laptops middle schools have been using for the last several years. I believe perhaps what is being referred to is the previous Lenovo devices. So the laptops being purchased for this cohort have similar features but are a different brand. So these laptops are a convertible tablet with a touchscreen. It's roughly 11 inches in screen size, and it has a convertible keyboard. There's a question about whether or not teachers who are currently using Schoology, et cetera, will need to use Edmodo. Classroom teachers often try many innovative platforms in their instruction, but similar to the way that the district has standardized on Progress Book for grading, and all teachers need to use that platform to have consistency from school to school and classroom to classroom, the same is true of Edmodo in a launched ed school. All teachers will use Edmodo in some capacity, but they may also use products like Google Drive for other elements of instruction. All right, let's go ahead and keep moving, and we will pause again for a question break in just a moment. So there'll be additional opportunities to ask questions after this very next section. So let's take a look at what you can expect in terms of changes in instruction. The first big change will be explained by Chris Ariotti, who will be talking to us about how students use and access the internet at school.
All right, so students will start using online applications as part of their learning experience. Applications such as Gmail, Calendar, Google Drive, and Google Application Suite will be the tools that they will use to collaborate and complete assignments. They will also begin using Edmodo and other OCPS-hosted systems that provide educational content. The schools have been updated to have Wi-Fi in all areas of the school. Now, that process for the schools hasn't been completed, so be aware that we are still in the process of updating that, but the new schools will have their Wi-Fi updated completely by the start of school. Internet filtering and security settings are set in compliance with the SIPA regulations. So students are prevented from accessing applications and websites that are not on the approved list, and all internet activity is logged based on the device user. Students will have access to many new tools, and it will be important for parents to understand how that access will change what they see every day. Many of the materials we grew up with, such as notebook paper, poster board, pencils, markers, will still be in use, but will have a digital alternative in the cloud. For example, students can take digital notes in Google Docs or create engaging presentations in Google Slides without ever touching a traditional tool. The best part is you never have to worry about a student losing their work because it's accessible 24/7. You won't need a jump drive or a SD card to store their devices because they're all up in the cloud.
Thanks, Chris. Great digital tools give students the opportunity to create great digital products. Our hope is that students will be completing far fewer worksheets and showing us what they know in more dynamic ways by creating products such as digital ebooks, infographics, e-newsletters, and even websites. The possibilities are truly endless when it comes to digital learning. So if the classroom is going to be so different, how will testing change? Well, students have been taking state standardized assessments online with more interactive elements for a couple years now. This is likely to continue, but we will also be taking online assessments in class, including what you might think of as typical chapter or unit tests or everyday quizzes. What questions do you have about the changes to instruction? I see one has come up about the different sizes of devices. So the state of Florida has a minimum screen size that is required for assessment. That screen size is mirrored in these devices. And so we do not have a variety of sizes of devices. However, we do enable the ability for magnification for students with unique needs on these devices. And we also provide a universal design for learning toolbar called Read and Write for Google that allows things such as text-to-speech, visual vocabulary, highlighting, screen reading, and those sorts of things, which can assist students in a variety of areas.
As far as the available bandwidth at schools, this is a technical question from James. We're specifically upgrading all the sites as we go through, so it's not going to, where your school is currently slow, we are going to be upgrading the bandwidth start of the school year, so that way they'll have enough bandwidth for all the new applications and viewing the videos as they necessarily need to. Bandwidth is dynamic for us, so we do make sure that we're constantly monitoring that. And as it is, we will increase bandwidth as needed for the schools as they go into whatever testing cycle or planning sessions that they have with the need for more information.
I love it. The questions are really rolling now. So one of the questions is, who can access the students' work in Google Drive? So Google Drive is password protected. Secondary students, which would be middle school and high school students, set their own Active Directory passwords and are able to reset their password at any time if they feel it becomes compromised using a series of password reset questions. That work, once shared by the student, can be seen by their classroom teacher or, for example, if working on a collaborative project, by another peer once they've initiated the sharing. There's a question, Chris, that I think would be great for you to answer, which is about connecting to your wireless printer at home. I recall last year we provided some directions about that. I know that there's some limits there.
Yes, I'm unfortunately not as well-versed as some of the technical guys that have actually solved that problem, but I do know there was some issue. There is a wireless connectivity process that we can go through, and that is documented. I can have that published on the website so that you guys have access to that.
Great, thank you. There's a question about parents having direct access to Google Drive. So oftentimes parents ask us if they have their own private login to their student's Google Drive. And the answer to that is no. The Drive account is your student's. Now, what can happen is your students can certainly share those credentials with you, and you can also share a student's Google Calendar with them. However, inside of Edmodo, all parents are issued their own credentials for which they can go in and see the groups associated with their student. So that is a separate process. And the reason for that is one is the district's learning management system where the teacher is giving you access to the group, whereas the other is the student's private work. We're going to be posting, I see quite a few questions about the printer. We will go ahead and post those directions and procedures onto the digital.ocps.net website, and I'll have Allison post that website in the chat box for you. But I would like to encourage you to remember that students will not be required to print things to turn them in. The intent of the program is that students turn their work in virtually to their teacher by either sharing their document or uploading it to Edmodo. So it certainly is a perk to be able to connect wirelessly, but it is not a requirement.
I see a question regarding if a machine breaks down at home, can the student bring the bring up the information on a Mac to complete their work? From all my knowledge, Google will work with a Macintosh. So you should be able to do anything they need with the Google Docs and actually Google Drive. So there should be no limitations as to which device you try to connect with. In fact, we do have many devices in our first cohort that are iOS-based, Mac-based, and Chrome-based. So we do know that it actually tests out perfectly fine for any of the devices.
Okay, we have time for one more question before we move on, and then we'll definitely make sure to get back and answer all of these. So there's some great questions here about online textbooks being available for purchase or through the school for those that prefer a paper copy as well. So at this time, the way that that process will work is that the district provides an online textbook for all students. And then there are class sets of paper-based books in the classroom, but they do not travel back and forth to school. Of course, many of these things are available from a private institution, but the district provides the electronic copy to students as a part of this program, and then a class set of paper books, at least in core subjects for graduation through the beginning of this transition. All right, so we're going to go ahead and move on, and then we will come on back to this piece. And I know Allison will be monitoring the chat box and making Chris, Tricia, and I aware if there are some questions that require our immediate attention. So let's talk about the most important changes that parents will see in terms of how you interact with students from home. There are going to be changes to things like reviewing the student planner, how you review student notes and work, parent and teacher communication, accessing textbooks, using the internet at home, and the parent responsibility for the student device. So the change you're going to see even on the first day of school will be that students will not be issued a paper planner next year, but will rather maintain an online planner which you can access on the go. This is great news for parents because it will let you get the information you need right when you need it. You also won't have to worry about your student losing your planner, having to pay for a new one, or having that planner suffer the fate of being so dog-eared that you can't even read it. You're also going to notice some changes to the school supply list this summer. Parents can save time and money by purchasing fewer school supplies. Students will need far fewer, if any, binders, folders, and notebooks. They will keep all of their work in an online folder, such as Google Drive, as you heard Chris explain earlier. This should really save you some time this summer. It'll also be easier than ever to talk with your student's teacher through our district platform Edmodo. Edmodo has the ability to download a mobile application that you can use on your phone to get the latest announcements and information about student assignments from your child's teacher. Now, we talked a little bit about the changes to the textbooks that we'd provide, but we did not yet explain how you would access them. So all of our electronic textbooks, as well as our software that we provide to all students, can be accessed through a very important website, which Allison will place in the chat box. That website is launch.ocps.net. When students sign into our Launchpad, they will have a single dashboard of all of the textbooks for their classes, as well as software like Typing Club, Gizmos, BrainPop, and many more things that the district provides to all students participating in the LaunchEd program. Chris, why don't you tell us a little bit about how we're going to use the internet at home?
Sure. You know, students don't have to have internet access to complete homework assignments. Let's just make that clear. But if a student accesses the internet outside of school, though, they will still be filtered as if they were in the school. The device is configured to use OCPS filtering no matter where it accesses the internet. That's a very important thing to remember. A map of free Wi-Fi in the community is available on our website, digital.ocps.net. And also, free home internet access is available to eligible families. Students already participating in the free or reduced lunch programs are already eligible.
Great. Tricia, can you explain to parents a little bit about their responsibility for the student device?
Sure. With your with the parents' or the guardian's permission, a device will be assigned to the student at the beginning of the school year. And actually, schools will be rolling out notices to parents as to when that date happens. These devices will remain the property of Orange County Public Schools, even when they're in the student's possessions off of school campus. Because the electronic equipment can be delicate and costly to repair or replace, risk management and safety and security are asking parents and guardians to maintain proper handling and care of these devices by both the student and all other household members. Please also consider establishing some guidelines on how to use the device, its applications, internet, and other features, and together acclimate into the new venture of digital literacy in a safe manner. Another thing we'd like to talk about is the regarding the parent responsibility of the student devices is what happens during damages or the loss or theft of a device. In the event of a damage or a loss of a device, it is the responsibility of the parent and student to timely report this incident to OCPS, particularly the dean of the school. For damages, please notify your dean, and if the device is lost or stolen, immediately contact your tech hotline at 407-317-3290. OCPS works closely with local police agencies to recover any device that we deem stolen. These devices are etched with both the hotline number on it and our information. As you know, students may be charged for a fine or an assessment for the damages or unaccounted assets that we assign to a student. For example, students are responsible for textbooks, library books, musical instruments, sports uniforms or equipment, and any other OCPS asset. This device is the same. No matter the fault in the damages or the unaccounted for device, the fine that we use, the term fine, is actually more like a charge or deductible for having the use of the device. Very similar to, let's say, your smartphone and you have an insurance program on it. You're charged a deductible and then the repair or to the damage of the device is handled. And so this is the same here. OCPS will charge you that assessment. And for that, we would ask that you please review the digital learning agreement the parents or guardians will sign prior to the device being assigned to the student.
Thanks, Tricia. I know that there's a lot of questions about asset and risk management. There is every single time. A big one probably is, once I flip this slide, how am I ever going to remember the large yellow box phone number? That is actually etched on the back of your student's device along with the LaunchDead logo. By etched, we mean actually carved into the plastic, not an actual sticker. So that phone number will be with your child always. We're going to pause again because I know the asset management questions are likely to roll in. But I also see quite a few ICTS questions. So we're going to start with a few of those technical questions with Chris, and then we'll take back over.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to really try to touch on all of these, so bear with me as I go through these. One of the questions is around student access to the internet. Is that parent controlled? ICTS actually is working with teaching and learning to make sure we do provide the correct content for the students, and so therefore we do make sure that the limits are set appropriately for what they need access to. It is a district-controlled access, so we basically will work with the different programs to make sure they have access to what they need. So it's not going to be something that can be controlled from home or from the school. It's actually centrally located here. As far as upgrading the operating system or even patching the operating system on the devices, we have a central management system. As far as we use the SMS system here to actually manage the devices and the operating system. So basically any patching or upgrading of the operating system is done centrally here from the district central. So there's no need for the student to have to worry about the device being patched or updated at that point. And as far as being able to use a Mac from home, of course, that's something you could or could not choose to do. It's up to you as far as how you want to access the Google documents.
Chris, there's one more question at the bottom about the tracking mechanism for the device. Do you want to talk a little bit about CompuTrace?
Certainly. CompuTrace is actually a vendor that we've partnered with that is basically installed on every device of the student, any one of the devices the student carries. It basically allows us to track the device in the event of a theft or being lost or stolen. That device is actually not, that software is not part of the operating system. It's part of the machine itself. It's actually loaded in a portion of the device that's not touched by the operating system. So basically we can activate it at that point and track the device down to where it needs to be recovered. It is safe to say we do get a good recovery rate with that software on there. So in the event that the device is stolen, we should be able to get that device back.
Great, thank you. Well, Allison's fingers are really flying now. Your questions are coming fast and furious, so I'm going to try and grab a few for her. One was about whether or not they come with cases or bags. No, as Allison mentioned, they are military specification, which in short means they can sustain a little more rough and tumble than maybe the average consumer laptop. They can have a certain drop rate, etc. So we do not provide those specific cases or bags. The other question was who installs updates on the machine, and that's something that is done centrally through the district office. There was another question about filtering websites. Our district does maintain SIPA compliance, as Chris mentioned earlier, by receiving our filtering through Bright House Networks. And we have both a list of categories that is whitelisted as well as specific websites that are blacklisted. There's also, as a courtesy to parents, the ability for that internet filtering to continue outside of the school day. But remember that no internet filtering is infallible, and you must always supervise your students at home to ensure that they do not access content you do not want them to, as each family's understanding of that inappropriate content tends to vary. In terms of BYOD, which stands for Bring Your Own Device, if a parent chooses not to sign the digital learning agreement that Tricia talked about, there are provisions in board policy for a student to bring their own device. However, that device must be meeting the minimum specifications indicated on the BYOD, or Bring Your Own Device, matrix for secondary schools. For example, that student would need that device would need to have a certain screen size, have a convertible keyboard or a keyboard at all. It wouldn't be able to be just a tablet. It would also need to be a Windows 8.1 device at the secondary level, as that is the district standard. I saw another question about whether or not you can access your textbook on your cell phone. We'll need to do some research about that, because each vendor provides access to the textbook, and some of those textbooks are HTML5 and some are not. They're just fancy PDFs. So it may vary, but we can certainly work with vendors to provide a guide on which are accessible via mobile devices. I was very happy to see that one parent answered another parent's question about typing by saying we have Typing Club, a free resource. So, woohoo! We do not teach typing as a separate class as a part of this initiative, but rather that the technology is used to produce and publish writing rather than a paper and pencil. So think about it as on-the-job training. We do, however, encourage the use of the district typing software, both for recreational and academic purposes, beginning in second grade. That is called Typing Club. It's available at launch.ocps.net, and it's a great way for parents to see and monitor how many words per minute their students can type. One other question referred to students being able to download software onto their device. In general, software downloads are prohibited by students. However, there are some provisions for students being able to automatically install an update pushed by the district, or, for example, install a Google extension like a PDF reader that may be needed. But those extensions as well are also whitelisted and blacklisted. The district certainly cannot prevent parents from purchasing paper copies of books from a retail location. And if your child requires a paper accommodation as part of an individual education plan, then that's something that you would need to speak with your school staffing specialist about. Whitelisted basically means that an app or a website is allowed, and blacklisted basically means it's not.
It literally refers to a list that is actually maintained within the firewall, the blocking software. So basically that is a list that we maintain and it's actively viewed every time a request is made, so that basically it knows whether it can pass it or not pass it, depending if it's white or black. It's just a term that's been thrown around in the networking technologies.
I see a question about how students will share documents if email is blocked by the district. Well, two things to note here. Part of Google Apps for Education is that all students are provided with a Gmail account, and that Gmail account can be used to communicate with other teachers and students who have an OCPS email address, as well as colleges, universities, and government organizations. But the primary way that students share documents is actually using a fun little button in the top right corner of a Google Doc that says Share, where they are able to put in another student's name, and it deposits a copy of that document into their student drive. So it's a easy peasy lemon squeezy and doesn't even require email. Okay, so we are going to move on with our last couple slides, and then we are going to come back with another opportunity to ask some questions. So I think the root of most of these questions is, what can I do to help prepare my family for what is likely to be a big change for many students? So the first thing you should plan to do is to attend the face-to-face open house at your child's school. And once you're there, you should learn how to check your student's online planner, their binder, their Google Drive, and their grades. And again, that's more the how-to clicking each individual piece, okay? You'll also learn how to communicate with your student's teachers, how to help your student with their online homework and where that homework will be accessed, how the school and family will be held responsible for the device. And there's some great scenarios in a game that you can go through that highlight some typical adolescent behavior and how the fine structure applies to those things, and how you can actually sign the online consent forms for your students to use the digital device, access the internet, and have online accounts. Now, your principals are just now setting the dates for those open houses, though they are likely going to be between the last week in July and the first week in August. You're going to receive actually a paper invitation to your home address that the school has on file in mid to late July, as well as an email. Now, I know several parents had said in the last session that they received the voicemail about today's session but did not receive an email. That could be because your email that's on file with the district isn't current. I know that my email is certainly not the same as when my students started here, and so you're going to want to update that with your school's registrar to make sure that we have the most current email address possible. In the meantime, leading up to the open house, you're going to want to do something that sounds kind of funny in the face of all this digital learning, but it's just to have a good old-fashioned family meeting. Before the device even comes home, the first thing you need to do as a parent is set limits and consequences for the things that are important to you outside of the school day. We've got the school day part under control. But outside of the school day, you're going to want to make sure that your student knows the limits for downloading media such as video and music, visiting video websites such as YouTube, like the one you're on now, how you feel about personal social media rather than the academic kind, whether or not you will allow your students to play approved games on the device, whether or not you'll allow them to use the Google Hangouts or chatting features within Google Apps for Education outside of the school day. You're going to want to make sure they understand and that you reinforce not to share private information online and that you set limits for screen time outside of the school day. Maybe even more important than all of that, the first thing you're going to want to do is discuss how to take care of that device and whose responsibility it is in the end. For example, will you have a single place to put the device at the end of each night? Can they keep it in their bedroom, or would you be more comfortable with it in the living room? Can they use it outside, on a boat, in the rain? Right? It's a little bit like a Dr. Seuss book. But how do you expect them to use the device, and have you made those expectations clear? There are pretty few things that come with a monetary consequence at school, but this is one of them. So we want to make sure that your expectations and ours are clear. So we're going to wrap up the content part at this point, but we still have about 15 minutes left that we can answer questions live and make sure that you have all the information you need to feel comfortable before signing off tonight. If for some reason you have a question that's personal or that you feel that you need to ask after 6:30, you can email that question to digitallearning@ocps.net, and we'll put that question in that email address in the chat box. There's a question about the consequence for gaming on the device during the school day. That would be covered under the provisions in the OCPS Student Coding Conduct for inappropriate use of technology. That can be a level 1 to level 4 offense, depending upon how many times that student has been disciplined for that. And that would be a question that your school's dean can help you work through. There are a range of consequences, not just one, and those are really dependent upon the situation and the student. What kinds of websites are blocked on the filters? Well, things like adult content, gambling sites, and certain types of e-commerce are among the popular categories. Things that are open would be search engines, a variety of educational and research sites, certain types of social media, for example, Edmodo, and other sites that have been placed on the allowed list by the teacher or district. Gaming out of school is kind of a unique question. It really depends on how that gaming is taking place. For example, if that gaming was happening on a website which was allowed through the filter, then it would be the parent's responsibility to monitor and supervise that student and set those expectations at home. If it was discovered that the student was gaming on a site that was somehow being accessed through a proxy server or subverting the filter in some way, or that they had gotten around the restriction to downloading software by altering the device, and those things were reported or discovered at school, then it would be able to be disciplined within the provisions in the OCPS Code of Student Conduct. So there are a few questions coming in about social media and how that applies to the blocked site list. So a few pieces. The district supports the use of Khan Academy, among other educational content that can be found on YouTube. We do apply the safe search settings to YouTube, but YouTube is unblocked for high school students, and the filters that prohibit the use of or prohibit the adult content to pass through are applied as well. There was a second question about social media as a category being blocked, and for example, a site like Tumblr. The district has a board policy, that allows us to identify a small set of social media sites that can be used for academic purposes. That site is what we would call on the allowed list. So for example, Facebook, which our schools have to use as a mechanism for communication, would be unblocked for high school students only. Whereas a site like Tumblr is not on that allowed list from the school board and is blocked. So in social media, we block as a category and then have basically a few exceptions to the rule that we have in place because they're district provided for academic purposes. I see that Allison has answered most questions. So if there are additional questions outside of the ones that she has addressed, now is the perfect time to ask. We're all ears. This video presentation is being recorded and will be made available on digital.ocps.net, likely tomorrow because it will take some time to convert, and will also be provided to your school's administration so that they can post it on social media or your school's website as they see fit. It looks like there might be a question about if land school functions outside the school day and whether or not we just basically you cannot. It is not a teacher's choice whether or not they can view it outside the school day. It literally only works during the school day, and it is tied to the teacher's roster, meaning they can actually only see your child's device during the period in which they are teaching or instructing your student. Elementary and middle schools at this time are not part of cohort 1 through 5 in terms of the new beyond the schools already listed on the sheet. But certainly the district is looking into scaling forward with middle schools and elementary schools. And at the time that an elementary school goes digital, they are provided with an interactive device like a smart board. That's a great question, Natasha. So teachers begin professional development in advance of the digital learning initiative. Each school has a team of 5 digital curriculum teacher leaders that are selected by the school administration. And those individuals go to training. They began training in December. And then they bring that training back to their campus and share what they've learned and train their staff. And that training has been going on since January and will continue through July. Once the school actually goes digital, or launches, as we like to say, the teachers don't just stop learning there. They engage in an additional 3 years of training periodically. That help them to move from the basic entry level of technology use all the way through very transformative high level technology use. So we do our very best to support teachers as we know that this is a significant change for many. Again, we do currently have several one-to-one elementary sites. Weatherby, Millennia, Millennia Gardens, and Pinewood are one-to-one elementary sites. And Audubon Park, Windermere, and Sunrise are the district-designated Bring Your Own Device schools. Okay, well, seeing that there are no additional questions, I'd like to thank those of you who have attended this evening and encourage you to continue communicating with both your school and our office. You're welcome to contact Tricia, Allison, myself, or Chris at any time. And once again, you can email additional questions to digitallearning@ocps.net. I know that some of you may have additional questions, but those of you who don't are free to go enjoy your evening. I know that we're taking time away from your family. However, we will be online for another 9 minutes for those of you who have questions. D'Elisa, can you identify what you have applied for? I'm not sure I understand. Hi, Ms. Arnold. So I'm very excited to say that our district has invested more heavily in bandwidth than just about any other surrounding district. We are very fortunate to enjoy the strongest wireless internet really in Central Florida. We have had very few, if any, internet outages in the last 3 years since we began the program. And we do load testing at each school where we basically simulate what it would be like for every device to be online at the same time, doing the most high-powered work possible, video streaming. And then we adjust the internet bandwidth at the school to handle that load. We also have an agreement with Bright House Networks that allows us to monitor and reallocate bandwidth out of a single pot rather than have it dedicated to each school. So for example, if we notice that at Ocoee High School they're having an especially exciting day, then we can reallocate bandwidth. Chris, do you want to add anything?
We can touch on that. Basically, we have an agreement based on that pot of available bandwidth to reallocate that anywhere we need in the district and be able to manage that surge of data need as necessary. So we have not had any issues in the last year as this, we've been upgrading the system in place and making sure that we have the initial, the necessary technology in place to make that bandwidth instantly available for the students' needs.
Thanks, Chris. You're much better at explaining that than I am. Ms. DeLisa, Allison is going to get you the contact for the school choice office. I apologize that you haven't heard back, but we'll make sure that we put you in contact with the right people. Mr. Medina, your question about being the first county to implement the switch to digital. No, I wouldn't say that we have that distinction. There have been districts all around the country, including some in Alabama, North Carolina, California, who have all gone digital. Within our own state, there are one-to-one initiatives happening in many of the large urban school districts as well as small ones. What I can say is that Orange County Public Schools has the distinction of being the first school district in the state of Florida to provide every high school student with a device at the time that they enter freshman year, beginning this August. And that's very exciting for us because that's over 73,000 devices between the entire program that we have been able to put out. And we are just thrilled that we can support students with the support of our community. There's a few other questions that I think are worth noting here. I see a question about having aides in class. So, I believe what's being referred to there is paraprofessionals. We have not identified in the previous three cohorts that there is a need for classroom aides to support students as a result of this, though certainly we do have paraprofessionals in place to support ESE and multilingual students as a part of those existing programs. Students, quite honestly, pick up on digital learning even faster than we do. I learn more from our high school students every day than I could from any training. So many of them are far advanced to us. The district doesn't provide the option to rent or buy paper copies of textbooks. However, as I stated earlier, we do have paper copies available as a class set for use during the school day. And if for some reason your student has an individual education plan or other requirement that requires them to have a paper textbook, you can certainly work with your school's staffing specialist. The textbooks that are being used are the state-adopted textbooks. So, for example, inside of English Language Arts at the high school level, we use Houghton Mifflin Harcourt's collections. That's our state-adopted material. And rather than having the paper textbook at home, you'll have the electronic version. So there's a couple questions that I'm just kind of scrolling through to see. I see that there is a question about Launchpad not being accessible. So I do want to clarify that the system being down is different than the internet being down, just for the parents, since I know as a staff member you're probably aware, but not everybody can make that distinction. So if you are ever in a situation where the publisher's website is to be offline, let's say for scheduled maintenance, and then you would have that classroom set of paper textbooks to use during the class period for a limited interruption for, let's say, scheduled maintenance or something like that. You know, honestly, I don't know the answer about the taxes personally. And I'm not sure which taxes you're referring to. So what I would love to do is if you'd like to post your email address in the chat box or send it to us privately at digitallearning@ocps.net, we can certainly have our team from financial services get in touch with you to answer your questions more accurately and directly. I can answer your next question, though, which is, will the laptops be used in art classes, band, theater, and chorus? So the answer is yes. In fact, I find when I'm walking through classrooms, our most innovative and exciting lessons seem to be happening in some of those fine and performing arts classes with the laptops. For example, I was in a class just the other day that was ceramics, and they were actually looking at ways that they could model the ceramics online first, kind of like a blueprint, and then actually build the ceramic vase face-to-face. It was really unbelievable. I was in another fine arts class where they were collaborating on the composition of a collage, basically like a pop art project, by pulling different pieces of art together in a shared document, and then replicating that in a face-to-face environment using traditional materials such as colored pencils and paint and crayons. So there's really no limit to what you can do with it. And we see the same sorts of things in performing arts too. So the student can bring them the device with them from class to class, and our fine arts teachers and performing arts teachers are involved in training. If there is an outage for Launchpad, for example, scheduled maintenance, then yes, we can notify parents and students through either Gmail or Parent Messenger. And if, for example, a single application is down, so for example, the typing club tile isn't working or something like that, then we can actually post a notice inside of Launchpad, kind of like a banner. So I see that the Dawson family still has some additional questions. I'm happy to answer those questions offline. I know we have come to the end of our time together tonight, and I want to be respectful of those that are also on the call and likely are waiting for dinner. But if you contact us at digitallearning.ocps.net, we will happily schedule a conference call with you personally to get all of your questions answered or meet with your school representative. So please don't leave for the school year without having your questions answered. We are absolutely happy to help. On that note, I would love to thank all of you for coming. It has really been a great turnout and a really interactive dialogue. We look forward to talking with you again over the summer, and remember to be on the lookout for that digital open house invitation. Thanks again, and have a great night.